action, just 3 points or 4 points, or what can we do? And I don't want what we should do, but what can we do? Because in India, there's a huge difference in what, between what we need to do and what is actually feasible. So what is actually feasible? Plan of action, just 3-4 points. Dr. Shaori, my second question is to you. You gave some excellent suggestions, but do you see any kind of political consensus at all evolving on any of those? Thank you.
Yes.
Looked into the 10th schedule of the Constitution. Because I used to think, and I've been breaking my head with Madhukar for some time now, the 10th schedule has a systemic flaw, which both of you tried to point out. And my question is two parts. One is, would you agree or would you have anything to say if I said that the creation of 10th schedule in 86-87 has actually contributed to the degeneration of the debate and the quality part of the parliamentary functioning, because it has made debates irrelevant. And therefore, the adjournments and all the shouting matches and all the things that we have all cried about have taken place as a consequence of the 10th schedule particularly. And secondly, politically, and this is the question I think partly Mathili was asking about, what could actually be done, what is feasible. Do you see a political consensus emerging on 10th schedule, particularly now, because the larger parties have actually begun to feel the problem with the 10th schedule, which has prevented all political mergers? Last 15, 20 years, we have not had any political merger. And I don't think anybody in this room can actually say that we will ever have a situation like 1977, when the political combinations come together under one umbrella to fight an election. And 10th schedule is the single biggest element in this, because it has simply made exit impossible. You enter a party, you have a problem. So do you think this political realization among the larger parties might actually stimulate our debate and discussion, and therefore amendment to 10th schedule, if not its abolition? Thanks.
I'll ask Dr. Jalan to take first stab.
And the shorter the answers are, the more questions we can accommodate. Sir.
No, I think that, let me reply to Dr. Mathili. I have dealt with 10-point program and so on and so forth. And as you say, that we need not worry about what we should do ideally, but what we can do. I mean, for example, there are two or three things we can do right away. Why don't you apply the anti-defection law to parties which join the government and not only to the individuals which are members of the party? It's a very important point. But today you have created an incentive for any leader of any type to form a party of his or her own, if he wants to be counted or she wants to be counted. But otherwise, so you can shift around. If you are a leader, if you are a non-leader like me, you would be very happy to be wherever you are sitting. Second, which you discussed today, election financing. You know, the corruption and everything that you see, and the parties, power, etc., election financing. Okay. Now, why can't you use MP Lad funds for that? I mean, the whole country is using so much of money to give you so-called MP Lads. You don't have a budgetary problem. If you spend only 1-2% of your budget on financing elections, and we have also, I have somewhere else, described the criteria that you can use, which can be fair, just as you distribute anything, equity versus efficiency, largeness versus smallness, all these things can be done. Third, define, you revisit your entire distribution of power between central and state. I mean, here is a country which we are sticking to the whole economic powers in the state, and you called, I think somebody said, made a point about why does anybody want to be in parliament. Anybody want to be in parliament, if you have something to be done, it's great, it's very great to sit next to a minister somewhere. You know, you can approach him, you can talk to him, get your licenses done, lend something done, this thing, that thing, you know, you can get in. So, I mean, the whole, why don't you redefine the distribution of power? Law and order, you have just said, is state. This is planning, economics, everything is center. Why don't you reverse the process? That interstate terrorism or something would be federal. I mean, we have had 100, beg your pardon? No, but without legislation, you can't change. You see, if you say that 101 amendments we have made to our Constitution of India. Now, here I am only proposing things which do not cross party lines. There will not be a problem if we want to do something. And you know, so on and so forth.
We lose seats. In other words, if Karnataka has 27 seats and UP has 80, tomorrow Karnataka would have less seats and UP would have no seats. And I think, so they have to strike a balance between making sure that our representation is more representational of our population, at the same time not creating a disincentive for those states that have practiced better population management. And I think the solution they came out is remarkable. They said, we will freeze the number of Lok Sabha seats in a given state. So UP will have 80 and Karnataka will have 27. But within the state, we will redraw the boundaries to show the extent of population change. Now this to me is a classic compromise which has collectively arrived at. So I think we should not undersell the ability of the system to look at these long-term strategic issues, and that's frozen now till 2025. So I think there is, in all that chaos, in all that adjournment, in all that bags of money, there is an ability to evolve solutions that are equitable and at the same time long-term. So the parliament becoming more effective will make more people want to go to parliament. So maybe it's a chicken and egg.
Mr. Sharma.
Silicon comes to parliament. The question should be, can be, what structural changes can we make which will enable such persons to come? And I'll give you one suggestion. Earlier the whole discussion was on making smaller constituencies so that you have a greater, the parliamentarian can service the constituents better. I would go the opposite way, as Mr. L.P. Singh had done in a wonderful book called Electoral Reform. Actually, this whole myth that the member of parliament's job is to serve the private interests of his constituents should be broken by making the constituency even larger. And in the new club, you see, the smaller the constituency, for instance, the greater the weight, the influence of caste. You make India one constituency, to give you one example, as in a presidential election, there is no caste by dominating which I can become the president of India. On the other side, representation is important, talent is important. So supposing you club the existing 10 constituencies, make them one constituency, and in that 10, you have a list system. Every party puts up 10, I'll come to why, not only 10, but 50 or 30 candidates, and you go and vote for the list. If Congress party gets 30% of the votes in that particular constituency, then it gets out of the 10, 3 seats. So the first 3 names can be one solution. My idea is actually that instead of having a list of 10, each party should be obliged to put up a list of 30. So when the Congress is to get 3 of the 10 seats, the last step, which 3 of the 30 will come, should be by a random lottery. Just see the effect conducted by the Election Commission. Immediately, effect of caste is gone, so lottery. Effect of money is gone. Effect of my nexus with criminal networks is gone. And everybody will feel, every party will feel, I will burnish my list. I will enhance its appeal by getting talented people, 2-3 talented people onto my list. You will enable them. Otherwise, there is no way in which a person of the kind of creativity which we need, talent we need, integrity we need, is disabled from coming in because of the electoral system getting polluted. So structural change rather than incentives to individuals.
I'll take a last question. Yeah, please go ahead, sir. Okay, that's okay.